should have brought you one. I'm sorry. That's
kind of weird. Oh, no. I'm
on
like
a hot
at
day
this,
like this?
I'm like at this point where I drink soda. Like, I can tell, like, one can of soda can be better than another can of soda to me.
Oh, yeah.
That's mm-hmm. where I am with my soda drinking. It's not, it's probably not good.
Well, it's a refined, you have, like, a palate for
yeah.
it these days.
But anyway, here I am, here we are on Let's Gay. I'm Johnny Jungle Guts, the top-notch gamer, a.k.a. the top-notch gamer. And today on the show is my guest, sexpert, nail stylist to the stars,
wow.
Whitney Gibson.
Well, thanks. That sounds so nice when you say it like that.
Well, it's the truth. It's the truth. Who is someone of note that you maybe did their nails recently?
Recently? Who did
or
I work with recently?
Last.
I mean, I've done a lot. I've done, like, I like to, like, brag about the cool ones or, like, the heavy hitters.
Yeah.
I've done, like, Anna Wintour.
Wow.
Jennifer Lawrence. I've done Kylie and Kendall Jenner.
Oh,
I don't
wow.
know if those are, like, heavy hitters. But
they're
like,
heavy hitters.
It's something like that.
They're heavy
days.
Hitters these
they're
days.
They're of note, I suppose.
Oh, yeah.
But I've also done, like, people that I thought were really cool, like FK Twigs. And,
oh, yeah.
You know. I feel like I have an interesting book.
Mm-hmm. And how did you get started in that, in nails?
I was working at the Standard Hotel downtown.
Okay.
And I had been there for a long time, and I was just bored. And I started painting my own nails pretty religiously, like,
uh-huh.
and, like, kind of got into, like, the gateway drug of nail art, which is, like, leopard. It's very, very easy to do, and it's pretty satisfying. It reads well. People notice it and compliment you on it.
Uh-huh.
So I would do, like, a little nail art here and there.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, like, someone was just like, you should just do that professionally. And I was like, I don't want to work in a salon, no thanks. And they were like, no, you can do it on set. And it kind of just opened a whole, like, I hadn't really thought about it for some reason, even though, like, I'd worked, you know, I'd done art department jobs and things. I just never really thought about doing nails on set and it having, like, a living wage.
Yeah.
You know? So I just did it.
You just did
it. Yeah, well, I started doing it for, like, my friends.
Yeah.
People I knew who were doing, like, small shoots and test shoots and things like that. And then, you know, it just sort of progressed from there.
Wow.
Word of mouth. And then I signed with my agency a couple years ago, and that's how you get, like, good clients.
How you get Anna Wintour.
Yeah. You don't do that, like, off the street. That's, like, your agency secures that sort of shit.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I feel really lucky. I mean, it's... I haven't done it that long, and I've had a nice run at it, so.
How long have you been doing it?
Probably 4 years now.
Okay.
But
pretty
like
good amount
years,
of time.
2 years by myself, and then 2 years with my agency, so I feel like I've done, I don't know.
Seems like a long time to me. I mean, I don't know, there's those careers where, you know, like, architects don't get to really build buildings till they're, like, 55 years
old
or
totally.
6
or like,
years old or
you
something.
You gotta be a doctor for a long time before
mm-hmm.
you're a real doctor. Full
yeah,
doctor.
Exactly.
It's a technical term, full doctor.
So I never, you know, you never know with these careers. And then other people just jump right in. And you also have a show on Kchung Radio.
Mm-hmm. And that's like...
Renaissance Woman. Tell me about that.
So we do Wits and Giggles, me and my co-host, Shelley. And it's just a show about sex. It's two girls... We're stoners, and we just talk about sex. Just, like, things that we find interesting. We try to find, like, people that can talk about a specific viewpoint
mm-hmm.
from the average to not so average. We're interested in, like, the voice of the humans.
Oh,
you
yeah.
know? So we have a really good time. Sometimes we take callers and give advice, you know, unsolicited? No, it's usually solicited, but not professional.
Not professional.
Non-professional advice.
Who's a professional, though, in these realms?
In
these
the
realms of
sex.
What does it take to be
there's
a professional?
Some people, like Kinsey, he was like a sex.
Oh, that's
sex
true.
Boy. You know,
that's
were,
true.
Like, I think you could apply more. We're definitely really off the cuff, and we just kind of flow.
And yeah. there's Dr. Ruth, too.
Yeah, she's like, she's a doctor, right?
Yeah,
doctor?
It's in the name.
She's a doctor, right?
Oh my
gosh. I wonder
gosh.
If I could just call myself Dr. Witz, though, if that would work out.
And no, I'm sure no one would...
Because isn't Dr. Phil not a doctor?
Oh, I wouldn't be surprised. He seems like a charlatan to me.
Did you flim-flam?
I can't really tell,
selling
but...
snake oil?
I don't really... Is that what he does?
No, I don't know.
You don't know, but he
I don't
knows.
Actually, I don't actually really... watch that sort of daytime television.
No.
I can't really get into that. I like trashy shit, but I just can't watch it.
Dr. Phil isn't quite over the top enough, and it sort of feels...
like contrived and...
It's crazy because I love Oprah. I love Oprah.
You're an Oprah fan. Yeah, Oprah's different, though. Dr. Phil, I don't know.
But he comes from that world a little bit, or something, right?
She's the one that co-signed him,
Oh,
right?
Yeah, she was the one that put Dr. Phil, on, you know?
I mean, isn't it interesting how, really all you really need to be successful is a solid endorsement. If you're endorsed by the right person in any field, you're on.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like...
Do you think that's bad, or do you think that's just kind of the way it should be?
I think maybe we take people's opinions too strongly.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that every person that's been co-signed by a famous person is deserving of the attention. For instance, the whole crop of Kardashians.
Okay.
Does one give birth to another, do you want to continue to see certain areas spread? I don't know actually your feelings on them. I'm just curious.
I'll tell you. I really love Khloe Kardashian.
Mm-hmm. She's the funny one.
I also think that Khloe Kardashian, at this point, has legitimately been through a lot.
She really has.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This is Butters, by the way.
Hi.
We now have dogs in studio, and also my lovely boyfriend, Nehemiah, in studio. My assistant, Whitney. And she's funny, and I also just think that, I don't know how much... I am impressed by their ability to stay entertaining and relevant.
Yes.
Like, when the whole Black China thing started to happen, I just was... That was it for me. I was like, this family... anything could happen.
Anything could happen at this point. No, you would have thought that, I don't know, I guess Caitlyn would have been the top.
You thought that would have been the pinnacle of insanity.
Yeah,
but...
big moves. Bold moves. But no.
Culture shifting moves.
Yeah.
But,
I mean, there's some parts of their rise to fame that I think are actually progressive. I think some of it, though, is I don't know, there's some messages that I feel like I'm being hit on the head with that I'm not really...
Tell me them.
Well, I don't think that they put much value on anything besides physical attributes.
Yeah,
and
that's
that I think
possible.
Is problematic. Like, mm-hmm. I really feel like they should be maybe more philanthropic. I don't know. I don't know what they're up to. I don't keep up as much as I should, I think.
Sure.
Although I do have a mass text that keeps me abreast of certain hot-hitting things.
Hot
like Black China,
topics.
that was also my life. For
yeah.
Like, I was so into it for a second.
Oh, it was,
and it's a coup. It's like...
She's a folk hero in a way.
She's like... It's like mythology or
yeah.
something. Like, she... I don't know. She pulled off something unbelievable.
Yeah. It's really wild. But, yeah, I mean, I agree with you. The focus on the physical is absurd. And also the focus on the drama.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's not good.
Yeah, I don't think that's a good thing to be, teaching. I don't know. I feel like such a large percentage... I don't know. I'm going to get so preachy. It's just little girls. I feel like that's not what I want a whole generation
of
girls
to emulate.
If you had a daughter... I have
yeah.
a son.
You have a son.
And he's pretty uninterested in all of it. He's a gamer.
He's a gamer, yeah.
He's a gamer for life. So he's kind of not interested in any of that. He's aware, to some extent, of
sure.
certain celebrities, but not, not much.
Yeah.
But I do feel like the effect that it has on girls, I don't know, there's some body acceptance things that I think are good.
Yeah.
And then there's a whole lot of, your self-worth is based on how hot you can make yourself, and it's possible to make yourself hotter. It's not like it's not possible.
It's true.
But you're going to need money, and you're going to need to, I don't know. Like waist trainers and fit.
Waist
skinny
trainers?
Tea,
what's
skinny
that?
Tea.
I haven't heard about a waist trainer.
Waist trainers are just like a corset.
Oh, I thought it was like a person, a trainer.
Oh, they probably do have a specific, one of their trainers
trainer.
That's just thinking about that.
Oh,
that
boy.
Waist. Anyway.
Oh, man.
I didn't even mean to talk about this, actually.
Oh, well, that's all right. Now, let's get into the son gaming dynamics, because
yeah.
that's always really interesting to me, the way parents negotiate video games
yeah.
with the kids.
It's a really... I don't quite know how to navigate it. It's really like, it's a bizarre, if he could, he would play all day, every day. Like he would just,
that was me. Yeah. That was me.
I had some times like that too. I had a Super Nintendo that for like, you know, third, fourth, fifth, sixth grade, probably.
Sure.
Hit real hard. Yeah. And eventually you start getting into like, I want to sneak out and smoke cigarettes or whatever.
Okay.
And then for me, the gaming tapered off quite a bit.
Sure.
But he loves it. And I don't know how much, like, there's some days where I'm like, meh, go ahead, knock yourself out. And then there's some days where I'm like, is this good for you? What do you think? You had, like, tons of exposure to video games.
Oh, yeah. I had tons of exposure to video games, but I also had some limitations in terms of, like, how violent the video games were allowed to be at certain ages. And, you know, my parents would try to limit it. I was sneaky. Like, I think
my son's sneaky, too. I think he doesn't know that I know that he's sneaky.
Okay.
That's where I think we're at right now.
Yeah, and maybe my parents knew, too. I don't really know. Maybe they were just blissfully ignorant. Because my mom would always say, the thing about video games is that they're really easy to clean up. Which was...
Yeah. She liked that about them.
And my mom had 4 kids. Mm-hmm. So it was a lot. You know, and she was a working mom too, so it was just a lot. And my dad was in the picture, but I think that,
like, a contained thing for your kid to do is a godsend, and it's really easy to let him just do it.
Oh,
just go crazy. But you don't feel like it was detrimental to your development.
You know, I don't think that was. I wish that my parents had taken me camping or doing more outdoors stuff, which didn't really happen for me till high school at all. Like, we never went camping or hiking. But I don't think that had as much to do with just the video games as it did with Lyme's disease being really prevalent on the East Coast. Where are you from originally?
I'm from Washington State, but I've heard that a lot. Like, kids that grew up in summertime fear. Like, you didn't do stuff like that because you just grew, like, nervous.
Yeah, I just have this memory of my dad catching me going sort of... We went on vacation in the Poconos, which is kind of like this mountain area in Pennsylvania, I'm pretty sure. And I just remember
thought it had such a tropical sound to
it. I know, yeah, because it sounds like Kokomo, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we did that, and I, like, went off the beaten path, and I was, like, so excited, because I think I, like, even crawled, like, through a log or something. And I just remember hearing my dad screaming and emoting in this way that I never heard him get upset before, because he was so paranoid that I was going to get ticks.
Yeah.
And the thing is, Lyme disease, it's not, I know tons of people who've had it, and it's not that bad. I mean, it's bad when you have it, but you go on antibiotics and you're fine.
But isn't it like a thing that doesn't go away?
It doesn't go away. Technically, it doesn't go away, but everyone I know hasn't had a real resurgence of it. Anyway, I just wonder if that was also a little bit tied into just the...
But not everybody that gets bit by a tick gets Lyme disease,
that's
right?
True.
Like, it's not... Are all the ticks out there with it?
Deer ticks, if you have a deer tick on your body for more than 48 hours, it's pretty likely that you're going to get Lyme disease. But...
Whoa.
But I think it was also just that era, that was that safety craze of, like, white... parenting, mm-hmm. where you gotta have the SUV, so if you get in an accident, like, everyone in the other car dies, and your kids are fine.
Yeah.
You're like, you know, that type of mentality.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I don't think that mentality is gone.
No.
I think it very much still exists.
I think there's just an American obsession with safety that's just not present in a lot of other places, you know?
Do you feel like it's, like, oddly, like, our... fear-based society brings said fears to life. Like, I don't know how to phrase it, but you know what I mean?
No, well, yes, because I think if you want to look at it maybe more in a political way, you know, the response to, say, 9/11,
mm-hmm.
which I think we're still... Ooh, I don't know what's going on there. Oh, that's not good. We just found some spikes. Actually, could you read me this, the first couple sentences of that
right
at
here,
the bottom?
Cave of the Phoenix?
We're in the Cave of the Phoenix.
Okay. Enter the cave with your first team and step on the button to open the door.
We did that.
Press square to switch your second team,
mm-hmm.
and proceed through that door.
Did that.
Climb the stairs, then go right and down. Step onto the button above your other party to open the door on the right and have them go through it.
Okay, well, I think we took a little wrong turn here, so I'm going to backtrack. But what games does your son play? That's what I want to know.
Okay, so he is into... He really likes
And also,
Zelda.
How old is your son?
He's 10.
10, okay.
Yeah, his name is Seville. He's 10 years old. Gamer for life. That's like a thing that he says. He's wearing a t-shirt.
Oh, wow.
True gamer for life. So he plays, what does he play? He has like a bunch of different, on different platforms, he has Zelda. He actually only really plays, he has a 3DS. He plays, I don't really know. He plays Zelda. He plays Pokemon Shuffle. I also now play Pokemon Shuffle on my cell phone. And it's been a bonding experience for us.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll be like, yo, what should I use to take down? I can't remember anybody's names though. Like they don't, Pikachu's like pretty much the only one on my radar. And we actually watch the Pokemon show together, too.
Okay.
I spent hours the other day, like, folding laundry and trying to, like, get my bearings. Like, what's really happening here?
Sure.
It was really interesting.
And so those are all pretty good games in terms of, you know, they're not, there's no extreme violence.
Oh, no, he's not really into the violent ones yet. I think he's, like, aware that I don't want him to have them, but he's never asked me for them. He really is into like cutesy kind of shit.
Yeah,
he
so
likes
kind of like me
on my
now.
Phone. He likes Neko Atsume.
Oh,
do
I don't
know
that?
That
game.
It's a really silly game with a cult following. It's you have like a yard and you put out toys and treats for your kitties.
Oh yes, I have heard of
and
this.
And they just come through, and that's it. Like that's it. There's nothing else to it except for that there are rare cats. So combinations of certain toys and
right,
food will bring through
the rare cat.
Yeah, but there's really nothing to it. You know, like it's a total nothing game, like a Clickfest or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what do they call those apps? You know, the apps that are just like you're just there to like mine clicks.
Mm-hmm.
You're just clicking things. You're tapping a radish in the ground so
it
grows or what have you.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like that.
And I've heard a lot of praise of that lately as just like a meditative activity.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit.
Yeah, there's just no negative repercussions. Like people
mm-hmm.
are like, oh, it's like Tamagotchi, but it isn't at all because you don't have to check in on them ever.
Sure.
If you don't put out food, they just don't come hang out.
Okay.
No one's dying. No one's, there's no, there's nothing, there's just nothing negative.
There's no urgency.
But he's really into it. He has it on the iPad, and
uh-huh.
I have it on my phone, and we're, like, weirdly competitive about it.
Uh-huh.
Where, like, I'll be like, oh, yeah, I don't know if Frosty brought me a memento, no big deal. And he'll be like, you got a memento from Frosty?
Ooh.
Or he'll be like, so, you've been playing longer than me. Like, we're super competitive about the Pokemon game, too.
I hear ya. Well, that's good.
He plays other games that I can't think right now. Oh, no, he likes, Slither.io.
Oh, I don't know what that is either. I don't know what the kids are doing these days.
Well, we just had to Google the other day because he kept calling it Slither.io or Slither.io or like
something.
And then I heard another kid do the same thing. Like, I just thought he didn't have a grasp on it.
Yeah.
I heard another kid, and the kid's like, did the same thing. Like, went through three different weird half names for it. Almost like GIFs and GIFs, you know? Like, where people like stumbled on it.
Yeah.
And we looked it up, and it's because the website for it is slither.io.
Yeah.
So it's really just called Slither, I guess. But it's like a snake game. I don't know. You might like it. I'm not sure.
I'm going to look it up. Snake games sound good to me.
I mean, I guess it's got a real, like, people really like it.
Oh, yeah.
Like, there's a lot of kids. I've heard kids mention it a bunch in the last, like, month.
Uh-huh. Like, at school or something like
that.
Yeah,
they're just, like, all... Or we went to... I went to go drop off my rent check because I neglected to mail it on time. As one does. It's in Pasadena. Grown up. And the dude at the desk was playing it and tried to, like, minimize it real quick. But my son was with me, and he was like, oh, cool, you play Slither.io?
Oh, that guy must have felt about 2 inches tall in that
moment. I think he was, like, they were vibing.
Oh, that's cute.
They got, like, a common ground. They both play the same game.
Well, Zelda, I mean, that's the most critically well-received series of, like, all time.
Is it?
Oh, yeah. Like, the greatest game of all time. If you aggregate all the reviews for... Like, if you go, like, the top 100 video game critics' websites, lists of greatest games of all time, and you sort of aggregate those, Wikipedia has done this, Zelda is by far number one.
It's the melodic tunes, isn't it?
It's just, I think it's the puzzle solving, I think, was just really just big for people, and that it was,
Which Zelda do you like?
I really liked, there's one on the DS, well now I can't remember the name of it, but it was for the DS, and it was essentially, it had no controls, you just had to, use the touchpad only, and that was like the only way you could navigate it, and, that one was really good, I thought.
Is it old? Like it's a...
It's probably 7 or 8 years old.
Okay.
But Ocarina of Time is really great, which was originally for the N64. They ported it for a lot of different things.
We had Ocarina of Time on something, maybe Wii or something.
Yeah, oh yeah. They definitely put it out for that. That's a good one.
I knew the like Song of Sirens. Or, no, that's Game of Thrones.
Who knows? Are you a big Game of Thrones watcher?
I do the games, yeah.
It's funny. It's a sort of almost controversial to watch Game of Thrones.
It's terribly basic at this point. You know how things have this like quick arc from like cool to not cool because oversaturated?
Yeah.
I'm definitely one of the like common people because I watch
the Game of Thrones. Yeah.
Yeah, I pay attention to the games.
Oh man.
You don't watch it.
Oh no, I watch it religiously.
Oh, okay,
cool. I make YouTube video reviews of episodes.
Oh, I gotta watch them. I wanna see the last one, actually.
They're little quick ones.
Have you done a little quick one on the last one?
Yeah, a little quick one. It was just, that last episode for me, it was just so, because I've always despised Cersei Lannister. I thought she was awful. But after all of that went down, it just kind of felt like I was at this point where she just will do anything. She'll do whatever it takes just to be a bitch, kind of, and I kind of have to respect that, you know?
I mean, I tweeted, she's basically Black China. Okay,
yeah, bring it all around.
She got all the way down. I mean, she did the walk of shame. I really didn't think she was going to make it out of her situation. I thought she'd, like, fucked herself for life.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it was her fault. Like, the whole Sparrow.
Oh, no, she brings it all. She brings it all on herself, yeah.
Yeah.
But then
she's pretty evil. I can never decide who's the most evil.
I mean, I think Ramsay Bolton was pretty horrific.
Yeah.
He pretty much topped the charts for me.
Joffrey was really bad. Joffrey could have been a Ramsay.
Oh yeah.
If he would have lived.
If he made it.
Because he was real into torture. Like he was a sadistic bastard too. But Ramsay was pretty sadistic.
At this point, I don't really think any of them are... I would not describe any of them as good people. You know what I mean?
No, I mean, you kind of have... They're all...
Maybe John. John and Brienne. But I don't know if Brienne's just so obsessed with honor, sometimes it's a little unnerving, you know?
I'm curious about her angle. Like, what... I mean, I know what her angle is. It's honor above all else. But, like, everybody's got some, like, bullshit on the show.
Yeah.
Like, everybody has... There's no one without blood on their hands. Because even, like, I like Tyrion Lannister. But,
yeah.
I mean... He's done some shit. He's done some
He's done some really bad... I mean, he killed his girlfriend.
He killed his dad and his girlfriend.
And the girlfriend murder, I thought, was a little bit... I thought that was really awful. That was really unnecessary.
No, it was really, really sad. That one hurt my feelings. Because I was like... I wanted him to kind of still be...
He was good. Everything
good
before
dude.
That moment
and even
was...
even killing his dad. His dad had been a dick to him.
The dad was fine. I was fine with
rage,
the dad.
Rage, you know. But the girlfriend... And it's such a crime of passion way.
Yeah, there was nothing really logical about it.
No.
And,
I mean, she just hurt him.
Yeah.
But he didn't... I don't think that was well written, because he didn't have that, and that's not been his...
You don't think that was in him to do?
Oh, I mean, I guess it was.
I mean, that's how it was written.
It is known, I suppose.
It seemed out of character.
Yeah, like, too far. I mean, I know they're always doing some shit.
I mean, he's so great, too, you know what I mean? Like, I just think the acting and everything, he's just such a great job, you know?
Yeah.
So it was sad to see that.
Yeah, I mean, that's Game of Thrones for you, though.
Yeah,
that's
like, the
whole,
rip that's
out
the
your
whole
heart
point.
As often as possible.
Yeah.
Well, did you feel for Tomlin?
Butters, what's wrong? Come here, my dog is... So neurotic sometimes. Come here, buddy.
Is it like a stressful level or something?
It is stressing me out. I just aborted it a little bit, and now I'm getting back into it. I didn't really care, because I found him just to be pathetic.
Yeah, Tomlin always had, he was never cut out for it. He was never, you could tell from the beginning he didn't have what it took. You know, the boy king. And so, he waffled at anytime anyone stood up to him, he waffled, basically. I mean, he wasn't strong. He was weak. So yeah. It wasn't surprising, but I still felt.
I mean, he's a kid, too, so you gotta have some sympathy there, right?
Yeah. I mean, I just felt sad for him, because however misguided he was about what his relationship with the queen, Queen Marjorie, was, like, I don't know, I felt for him. And yeah. There was also just the way it was framed up. I could tell where it was going. Like, the way they stayed on the window, I was like, oh. I thought he was going to run at it.
But he put the crown down, too. That was so...
Yeah.
But anyway, you on your last episode, I can tell from this conversation, you're a big movie person. And on the last episode of your Kchung show, you guys were talking about sex
in movies.
In movies, mm-hmm. The way sex mm-hmm. is portrayed. And you asked a couple questions.
What questions did I ask?
I think it was like, what was your first memory of a sex scene in a movie?
Do you have answers for me?
I was thinking about it at the time.
Yeah, what was your first... What was, like, a movie that you remember having some... making a sexual feeling? You know, either you saw a sex scene in a movie.
Well, yeah.
Or it wasn't precisely a sex scene, but it gave you some sort of sexy feelings. You know, something in that realm.
The first movie I remember the sex scene from was in Excalibur, the 1981 King Arthur adaptation. It's with Helen Mirren as Morgan Le Fay. It's a really insane. It's really, really over the top. Everything's lit like green colors. Is one weird thing about it?
I gotta check it out.
Okay, wait. So, tell me what I'm. Okay, so wait. Open the door.
Oh yeah, yeah. Sorry. Okay. Did we already do step on the button at the top to lower the spikes, then switch to the other group?
No. Okay. That's the next thing to do.
Do that.
So.
Have you switched?
Here, just a second, because I think, here, just start from the beginning again, because I kind of effed it up.
Enter the cave with your first team and step on the button to open up the door. Mm-hmm. Press square to switch on to your second team and proceed through that door. Mm-hmm. Climb the stairs, then go right and down, step on the button above your other party to open the door on the right and have them go through it. Mm-hmm. Step on the button at the top to lower the spikes, then switch to the other group. Have them go up and over to the right, where there's another button. Am I going too fast?
Okay. So we went through the first door.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm going to see if I can figure this out here. So you grew up in Seattle?
No, I'm from Washington State, but I lived in, like, the central eastern part. So I kind of grew up in... I always categorized it as a small town, but now I have friends that are from, like, really small towns.
Yeah.
I don't really know. Like, it's Yakima, Washington.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, like, it's the apple capital of the world, or it was at some point. I grew up, like, in the middle of an orchard.
Wow.
But it's really, like, kind of rural, and there's, like, lots of tension between, you know, classes. Like,
right. Oh, really?
Like, yeah, there's a lot of bullshit, you know? It's like small town. I wanted to get out really bad.
Yeah.
I'm not particularly nostalgic for it.
Yeah.
But I also lived on the other side, too.
Are you, like, so sick of apples?
No, I fuck with apples.
You still mess with apples?
Yeah, okay. I'm cool with apples for life, I think. They're, like, a good source of fiber. But, yeah, so we would, like, sneak into the... Like, I'd walk out of my house and go into the orchard and meet my friends, and we'd make little apple pipes and...
Smoke weed
in the orchard.
Wow.
Hang out. I have nice orchard memories.
Okay, I think this way is the button to lower the spikes.
Okay, so step on the button at the top to lower the spikes. What's going on here? I don't get
this
at
all. Like, I'm so sorry. This is like a game that's over 20 years old. So the battle sequences are sort of in this very...
Like Battleship or something.
Yeah.
Like
strike, it's very strike. Sort of chess-like almost. Oh, one's dead here. That's not good. kind of thing. There's different characters. Some are better at magic. Some are better at... This is me.
Mm-hmm. I took it. Is that your first team?
My first team... I think this is the second team that I made for this one. Most of the game you don't split into, like, different groups like this. But in this one... Ooh, you do.
Who's your favorite of these characters?
I would have to say Shadow the Ninja. Mm-hmm. Because, his backstory sort of gets unveiled to you through these dream sequences where there's this really thumping sort of bass soundtrack, and it's very like abstract and sort of experimental in this way that I really like.
Do you make music?
I have, yeah. I was in a punk band called American Grizzly that was like a wildlife conservation punk band.
Combination.
Like, we would sing, and like other things, like we would sing about like how you needed to spay and neuter your pets.
It's an important message.
We had a song that was like about cats, and it was like, I love them, but they're sluts. Get your cat spayed.
It's accurate.
Are you a pet owner?
I have a dog.
What kind?
He's like a mutt. Mm-hmm. He's a black dog, a little fuzzy. He's the best dog, as it were.
Yeah.
The very best dog. I mean, I like your dog too. Your dog seems really cool. But, you know. I'm pretty biased.
You're pretty into what's his
RZA.
Name?
RZA.
Mm-hmm. Is that with the R's? Is that RZA?
Mm-hmm.
The RZA.
Mm-hmm.
Are you a big Wu-Tang Clan fan?
I think like my boyfriend and I. I mean, he's a way bigger fan than I am.
Sure.
But like collectively, there's
love there. I mean, the RZA is one of the great producers.
He's a Renaissance man.
Yeah.
I was flattered that you called me that, but that's a real
sure.
something to aspire to.
Mm-hmm. Yes. On the last episode of the show, we were talking about the anime Afro Samurai. The RZA did the soundtrack to
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm. I've heard it. It's nice.
It's pretty good.
Yeah. I think he's really good with soundtracks.
Yeah, he elevated that whole anime. That was a great anime.
I didn't see it.
It's really beautifully animated. And some great voice work from, I think, Sam Jackson and Hellboy. What's his name?
The
guy who plays Hellboy. Ron Perlman.
Ron Perlman.
Yeah. So, and where'd you get him, this dog?
He just showed up at our house.
Same with my dog.
Yeah, I mean, there's all sorts of ways to come into a loving relationship, I suppose, but it's particularly serendipitous when they just show up and you
mm-hmm.
like them, you know?
And how much thought went into it before you were like, I'm keeping this dog?
Yeah, it was like a slow thing.
It was a slow burner.
He was real cute. He had paint in his hair. He was real scared.
Oh, boy.
He's like the cutest. He's a real cute little long-eared, kind of furry, you know, he's a dog.
He's a dog.
So he's furry.
Yeah.
He's got four legs. And he just showed up and was like real skittish, and we happened to be grilling steaks, and we gave him steak.
Yeah.
And then we just like, we're like, well, we're not going to release him. He had no collar, of course. And so we just kept him, and we're kind of like looking for the owners, looking for a friend of ours that would take him. Like, he's so cute.
Right, something
you know?
Like that. You just
but I had, like,
figured
no,
there had to be someone who would
I,
do it.
But I did not want to take on a dog.
Like, right.
Although he was undeniably cute right from the beginning, it was
yeah.
not really what we were concerned. Like, we weren't looking for him.
Yeah.
And then after we'd had him about 3 weeks, I was outside watering my plants, and my neighbor over the fence goes, Shadow! And I look at him and I'm like, are you talking to the dog? Are you talking to RZA? Are you talking to the dog? And he's like, yeah, Shadow. And I'm like, is this your dog? He's like, you keep him.
Wow.
I'm like, keep him? Like, we'd been like looking for signs. We'd like, you know, he's not chipped. We'd like tried to find his owner, and it was just our next door neighbor.
And that's when you know you gotta keep him, because they don't care.
Yeah, they didn't care at all. But I mean, they have like 5 dogs. His niece had brought it over. You know, it was like one of those situations. But then I went back inside to tell my boyfriend this, like, discovery.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother was there, too. And I'm like, guys, the fucking dog is the neighbor's dog. His name is Shadow.
Yeah.
And my brother's like, yeah, Travis and I, that's my boyfriend, we were outside, and the neighbor said, Shadow. And I said to Travis, I think he's talking to the dog. And Travis was like, no, he's just saying hello. He's like, shut up. Because Travis is like obsessed with the dog from the beginning and just really wanted to keep him. So he was in denial about the neighbor.
Oh, yeah, that's what you do.
Yeah.
That's how you do it.
You just didn't, I don't know. I don't think he ever was trying to get him back. Like, he really, I don't think he wanted him.
It was the exact same thing with my dog. I would see him when I was walking my other dog at the time. And finally the owners were there, and I said, your dog is so cute, I want to steal him. And they said, you can have him. And I said, well, I better take him, because you don't care.
Yeah.
I mean, he's out here all day.
He's
a little puppy out here all day in the dirt, and I feel like he's going to be better off.
That's Butters?
That's Butters.
He's
yeah.
really cute.
He's cute,
yeah. He did
yeah.
well.
Mm-hmm.
He's a love bug, too, I can tell.
He's really sweet, yeah. Does your dog have any really weird anxiety habits, though, as little dogs often do?
Yeah, he's not tiny. He's kind of like a weird middle size. He's small enough, you know, he's not super, super tiny, but, we like to take him to a pool party. Got a lot of friends that are, like, will have pool parties, and everyone brings their fucking dog.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like, well, why would I leave him in the house? I guess let's do this, right?
Sure.
And then every time I do bring him to one of these, like, dog parties, it stresses me out because he's, you know...
You're always thinking about the dog.
Yeah, it's like having another kid. And at pool parties in particular, he's very anxious. Like, he thinks people are drowning if they're splashing.
Uh-huh. Or anything,
so he's just, like, at the side of the pool, scared and whimpering. Which I appreciate. It's sweet. Totally sweet of him.
Just a little misplaced.
Yeah, I just don't need it in my life when I'm sunbathing.
So we finally, I finally figured out what the heck I was supposed to be doing. So I press on this switch with the spikes. What happens next?
Okay. Where was I?
Okay.
You pressed on the spikes.
On
have
the
them
stairs.
Go over up this part?
Step on the button at the top to lower the spikes, then switch to the other group. Switch
okay,
to the other group.
That.
Have them go up
and over to the right where there's another button.
All right.
This lowers the spikes near your other party.
Okay. It's very repetitive. That's why I feel like it's... Okay, we're going over and down here to the right. Let's see if there's this... There we go.
It's kind of cool that now you can have the cheats.
Yes.
Like, you can just skip ahead. I did it on Mario not too long ago. There was some... I couldn't remember how to do... I was playing... Mario's my shit when I was a kid. Like, I have a strong... Specifically Mario, Super Mario World, I guess,
sure.
on SNES.
Sure.
Did you ever play that one?
Oh, yeah. It's really hard, too.
Yeah, it's challenging. There's a lot of stuff, and it's fun. I like that one. What am I reading to you now?
So we press the other spikes down.
Okay.
And then what's the very next thing to do?
Switch to your other party. The chest at the upper right is empty, but there's a chest at the lower right down a path that is somewhat hard to see. It contains a warp stone.
Okay, we're going to go get that.
Get the warp stone.
I've slightly missed that, but I think we can just go back up and get it. Yeah, that Super Mario World is great. And do you remember the part in, I think it's like one of the secret kind of levels where you just run along and then above you in coins it spells out, you are a super player?
Mm-hmm. That's the very end. I think that's if you beat all the super levels in the star. You know how you could like, whoop it into the star world?
Oh, yeah.
I loved that sound. There's so many good sound bites. I need to learn to be an electronic
music
producer.
Oh, me too.
Using all the like cool fucking sounds from. I mean, I know you can't really. You'd probably get sued if you used all that shit. But anyway,
people do it. Dram, who made the song Cha Cha, that created Hotline Bling. That's a sample from that area of Super Mario, which we're speaking of right this moment.
I know. And that's why when I heard it, I fell right in love with it. And it uses like the coin sounds and stuff.
Oh yeah. And then Drake has another song called Six God, which samples the minecart level in Donkey Kong.
Mm-hmm. The weird part is I knew that that was something. It, like, made me a little bit crazy. But I didn't do the, like, legwork at all until, like, I'd been listening to the album for a long time. And finally I was like, I gotta know why I know this sound. And then it was really pleasing to me because I also played the shit out of that game.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
Donkey Kong, that was a fun one. The only game I ever played that I think I didn't beat, that like I wanted to beat, was Banjo-Kazooie. Did you ever play Banjo-Kazooie?
Oh, yeah. Love it.
I could never beat that. You know, the witch, the like final boss stage is like four hours long. Yeah. It never ends. It's really, really long.
And she starts taunting you, like, she starts taunting you about
poem.
Yeah, in poem about how you should, like you should shoot eggs into her pussy at one point.
Yeah.
Like, she makes, like, these little double entendres that are super, like, maybe just too, like, was so shocking for a kid's game.
Yeah, they were so weird. Her whole tone. She was, like, a freaky... Like, she really was into some sort of, like, I don't know, there was some sadistic, masochistic things going on there.
Oh, yeah.
She, like, she could have ended it all, you know? Like, she had the power. Like, why would she fly around that roof and keep, or wherever it was, the top of that building?
Yeah. She's great. They need to bring her back.
I never beat that game, though, and it was really frustrating to me, like, to
well,
have
it's
that.
Hard.
It was just that last stage. You know what I did recently, though?
What?
I found a YouTube of someone playing the entire game. You know, it's like 14 hours long
oh,
or whatever.
Yeah.
And I watched the last 10 minutes.
Wow.
And it freed me. I was like, okay. I don't know if I cared, you know? Like, I tried really hard, but it's kind of cool that I'm fine.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm okay.
Yeah, I hear that.
It was just more eggs at the pussy is the key. That was really the whole thing. I neglected to throw enough eggs at her pussy. So.
Yeah. Yeah, that was it. There was, and then the other thing I remember in that game is you could be a bee. There was a point where you could be a bee.
I forgot about that.
That was like, whenever there was like a transformative moment in a video game, sometimes I would just go be that thing and then like not accomplish anything. Like just
yeah,
fly
it was just
around.
Like you just wanted to be in that zone.
I would like try to make like a little like theater piece out of that area. Like now the bee is flying to his house. Or something like that.
Like, not recording it, just for your
nothing.
Own.
Nothing.
Not even a performance
I might have been
people.
Saying it out. I would make my babysitter watch me do it. That's what I would do.
That's funny.
But
wait,
yeah.
Where are we at?
It says, we're supposed to do something to the right, but I don't see that.
Well, that's the tricky part. It says...
It's hard to see or something?
Yeah, switch.
Oh, did it.
You
here we are.
Found it.
It's going to be different in this translation. All right, here they call it the teleport stone.
Why is this translated differently?
Well, this is a Japanese game. The strategy guide that we're looking at is for the Super Nintendo version.
I see.
This is a more recent port with a slightly better translation.
Mm.
Really kind of an a lot better translation, depending on how you want to look at it. So a lot of the names are changed. The one interesting thing about this adaptation of this game is that the graphics... The entire fandom for this game thought the graphics were too good. They were too glossy. They were too sort of, they looked too much like an Android or phone game. And so
this part? Or
not this
general,
part, but
the
like,
graphics. Oh,
like this
that
part
stuff.
When we're walking around. But the thing is, this actually is not what those graphics are because I modded this version so it would look
a little worse. Okay. So you're a purist. You're like a fundamentalist.
Yeah, and you know, since I've done it, I've felt a lot more comfortable playing this game, you know? Because I was like, yeah, I'm going to beat this game, but it doesn't quite feel like the way I remember it, you know?
Isn't that weird?
Nostalgia, it's a powerful emotion.
It really is. It's
is like it good, a, though?
In this case, yeah, why not?
Why not?
This that switch, to me, is whatever makes you feel good. Like,
yeah.
You want it lo-fi? Get your lo-fi on. That's
mm-hmm.
fine.
Sure.
Did you descend the stairs and go to the left?
No. That's our next... The villains, the monsters in this area are not to be trifled with. They keep KOing my guys.
Ooh, I like Rob Max.
So, Rob Max. Yeah, Rob Max is...
That's a strong look.
I hadn't noticed that
before. Look at Deborah's, like, little lock thing.
Her, like, two side hairs.
Yeah. Not mad. I like people that try something.
Try something new. Sort of looks. Have you seen that new like the new supposed fuckboy style for 2017, which is like you know short on the sides, long on the top, but like with a braid in the side for white guys,
like a cornrow.
Yeah, a single like little braid, right, just like real tight on the head.
Sounds just like a fuckboy.
Yeah, it sounds bad. Sounds bad unless we're like in some type of like Mists of Avalon situation. Then
yeah,
maybe
if
could...
it's Mad Max or if,
yeah,
you know, if
we're
it's
in
apocalyptic,
something.
We are gonna do some weird braids in our hair for sure.
Yeah.
I'm going to.
Yeah.
I'm gonna like tap into a tribal thing if
sure.
the world ends.
Did you see that last Mad Max movie?
I did.
How'd you feel about it? It's all right.
It was like a romp. Like I was in it. I was watching it. I felt I got a little taken aback every time the guitar playing bungee person, it like took me out of it every time.
So oh,
I
yeah?
really hard at it. Like, I did, it wasn't bad, but it would just like break.
It was a lot.
It happened like 7 times where there's like high rising tension and then like, like, it was like a joke. I took Seville to see it actually, which I don't know, maybe that's questionable. I think it's R. And he and I were like in fits by the last scene because
that's
it was just
so great.
Well, it was like repetitive. They really used it a lot.
You guys sound like you have such a nice, close relationship.
We're close. I don't know if it's always nice.
Or
like,
also,
you know,
you're
how
just
it goes
a...
with a mom or like a parent in general.
Okay.
You know, I don't. Like, I know him and he knows me, but we can really, we're really, really similar. Like, I think no one tells you when you have a kid that, like, yeah, they're going to be this little mini you, but they're going to have the parts of you that you hate a lot, too. Like, you know what I mean? Like, they get your good traits, and they get, like, he's selfish like I am, and he's can be cunty, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
Like, he has my, like, snappiness, and it's really annoying to hear it in a little person.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
And he's not even, like, in that full middle school nightmare mode.
No, but
yet.
I think it happens early. I think, like, I don't know, it's the milk or something, but I think they're...
The kids are getting more evolved.
Well, when we
younger.
Were kids, there wasn't tweens, right? You were just a kid until you were a teenager. I mean, there is obviously like a shifting. I don't know. I also don't know how old you are, but
I remember the only reason there was tweens for me was because there was a Newsweek when I was in sixth grade when I was technically a tween. That was called like the Rise of the Tweens. I was on the cover of Newsweek.
Okay, so you've got to be like 10 years younger than me then.
Yeah, maybe. I'm 29, so
no.
No,
I'm 32. I don't know. I felt like tween came out. Maybe I just wasn't aware of it. I missed that Newsweek.
Well, I mean, things the youth culture changes so fast. But anyway, keep going.
All I'm saying is they're just moody. Like, I imagine if you had girls, to go back to what we were talking about, I imagine if you had girls at this point, 10-year-old girls are probably already moody and also already concerned with their looks. Like, my son doesn't give a shit about how he looks, but I see the little girls at his school
little girls,
already.
Yeah.
They're not, like, wearing makeup, but I see how they're, you know, they, like,
they're thinking about it.
Masquerading, you know, or whatever, like, experimenting with dress, and you know, it's interesting.
Yeah, I was listening to the Marc Maron with Laura Dern, and she was talking about how like her daughter, who's like 12 or 13, was like, well, Katy Perry started songwriting when she was 12, so I better get on it, you know, like
that motivates her, I guess.
That
That's
type
cool.
of like we like crazy level of ambition at really young ages, you know.
I mean, I'm impressed by that. I wish that I would have pursued more of the things that I loved.
Yeah.
Like, younger. Yeah, I mean, why not? I mean, you can't... I don't begrudge myself for where I am. Like, mm-hmm. I'm pretty okay with my, like, life choices, you know, as
yeah.
much as you can be.
Yeah.
But I do... I wish, like, someone... Like, I wish that I had a parent that is not the parent that I am, but someone that would have, like, really pushed... I wish I had, like, a tiger mom, you know?
Okay.
And I was, like, pushed really hard.
Yeah.
Like, you know... It'd be cool if I could play the piano.
Sure.
You know?
Yeah.
There but was I don't no do attempt that to, like,
at piano playing?
I think I did take one piano lesson, but it wasn't... I don't even think it was really... I think it was like someone else had a piano lesson and I met them there. I never took piano lessons as far as I know. I did like ballet and tap and tumbling when I was little, but never... I just wish that...
Good? That's all good stuff?
Yeah, but if you do, like, a year of something... Like, my son played t-ball for, like, 2 years, mm-hmm. but then wasn't interested anymore, and that's fine. Like, I'm not trying to force him to play t-ball.
Yeah.
But I also think, like... I don't know. Maybe I should make him stay in stuff. Make him have the follow-through that I never did.
My parents did that on some things. They did that for swimming. I remember... What was the... Oh, piano. Oof. That really... They just gave up on that.
Because you didn't like it?
Because I didn't like it and I wouldn't practice.
That's the frustrating part is I think if you're paying for something and your kid's not progressing because they don't want to practice, then it's like it's giving up.
Well, it was also just this thing where like it came time for the recital and I was playing like 3 notes or something. It just was embarrassing.
Yeah.
And I didn't even care. I was like, well, you're making me do this. I don't care about this, you know?
Yeah.
So they just gave up. But swimming, they made me do swimming for years.
Are you an excellent swimmer to this day?
I mean, in a way, it kind of paid off because they made us do sports in high school, and I did swimming for that, and so it was good in a way, I think, that they made me do that, because if they hadn't, then swimming in high school would have been a lot worse, or whatever I had done in high school would have been a lot less fun.
Yeah.
But
you would have ended up like me, smoking weed out of apples and orchards or something like that?
No, that was never on the docket for me, because my dad had made a bet about how I would, like, if I didn't do drugs or drink, I would get $20,000. Was his, like, strategy.
I've heard this sort of thing before, although $20,000 is a lot.
It was a lot, but he assumed that I would not do it. But he assumed incorrectly.
So did you get that payday?
No, because my dad's an architect. I turned 21 right as the recession hit. Mm. Like, right in that horrible moment. He had no work. He had to fire all of his employees, everything.
It's like a hard time to be like, what about that $20,000?
And so, but I did sort of still make off like a bandit, because he bought me a car. I did like a $8,000 used car or something like that. And $6,000. And then I did a trip to South America to go volunteer with animals.
That's amazing.
So it was really great. It was
and
still really
your
great.
Health. Do you still don't drink? Do you drink?
Oh yeah. No, I mean, I don't, I drink very little actually. I smoke, I'm a smoker of
you
weed.
Smoke a little herb.
That is fine. I've never smoked a cigarette in my life.
That's
never
good. They're the most pointless. I had a couple cigarettes last night, and it's definitely the reason I've got a headache through my eye today. Yeah.
What'd you do last night?
It's my friend's birthday, my friend Carl's birthday, and we just, you know, drank a lot at his house in Echo Park.
Yeah. So let's talk about the sex fascination and the ability to talk about sex. Where does that come from?
You know what? I don't really know. I don't think that I knew that there was some, like, calling. I didn't think about it at length before I did it. I, you know, applied for the Kchung show because I had a friend who actually she's been on the show, but she's affiliated because she's my friend, but she's not, you know.
Right. She's not, you know, part of the Giggles.
Yes. And she was DJing. She's got an amazing vinyl collection, just like the coolest, like, disco and soul and just stuff that I would want to hear at places. And she hadn't been DJing for a while, like, hadn't been doing gigs. And I was just like, what if I got a show and you could just have an hour to, like, play some shit, you know? She ended up not really, like, it didn't come to that. Instead, she couldn't go to the first show. She was going to be my first guest. I was going to have, like, rotating guests. And she couldn't come, so Shelly came instead. Mm-hmm. And it just really clicked. So Shelly and I, and my friend Fiona, too, who I was talking about, we're all close, and we all hang out and talk about sex together, like, very candidly.
Sure.
Like, girl talk, you know, or, like, you know, when people are not on the record, it's not hard to talk about sex with your friends, you know?
That's true.
Some maybe for some people, but I think for a bunch of girls, you know, we'll break it down, you know.
And that's interesting to hear that, because I'm not an expert on these things, but it always seems to me like guys talk about sex when it's just guys around more than girls do, and it's harder for girls almost to talk about sex.
I think that there is a lot of stigma, even in a time when we're supposed to be sort of like devoid of that sort of feeling, like. I think it's interesting because, I don't know, I don't really exactly know how to say this. It's like we're in this time where we're supposed to feel liberated and whatever.
Right.
Like, and there's almost like pressure to be
full
pro-sex whatever. And not everyone's actually comfortable with it. Like, not everyone's like, you know, if you haven't talked about it openly, haven't talked about sex openly your whole life, it's hard to one day be a flag-bearing pro-sex feminist bad bitch, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's so I think my friends and I are probably not unlike a lot of women who in a comfort zone talk about it pretty easily. And so that was kind of the concept. We were just going to play some, at the time, my focus was going to be 90s R&B and just occasional, like, just literally like girl talking.
Yeah.
And then it just evolved from there. Like, we started having guests come on and we started sort of like framing up shows more about things than not, you know, like more giving it more of a lens.
Sure.
And so we've had doms and strippers.
Wow.
And we have a show on Tuesday, and we have a dom coming on, and she's going to be fucking great.
Sounds awesome.
Yes, it'll be a good show. If you have any questions for a dom, call in.
Female.
Female dom, yes. Female dom. Her name is Grace Marie.
Oh, I know Grace Marie.
Do you?
Yeah.
She's going to be on our show.
Yes, I do know Grace Marie. We're friends on Facebook. I can't remember exactly how we became friends on Facebook, but she's great. I get a kick out of her.
Yeah, she is someone who exudes sensuality in a
and
way
confidence.
That is like, yeah, she's super confident. She's super like, she really is sensual. Like I probably overuse that word more than most humans.
Sure.
I think it applies more than people think.
Sure.
Not in terms of like necessarily sexuality, but just like a deep sensual experience, sensory experience. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But she's definitely got a sultriness. I'm excited to talk to her.
Yeah. That's cool.
I've met her before. Like, it. She's great.
Yeah.
So, anyway, so yes, we're going to do that. But the show, yeah, I don't know how... I would say of me and Shelly, I am the more conservative one.
Sure.
I didn't plan to be or think that I would be. It's just, you know, we've done like 40 shows now. So
wow.
It's like you kind of learn who you are through that. But I find myself taking stances that I'm kind of... I don't know. You know, we try to talk about stuff that's a little... that's fun and silly and whatever, but also like a little thought provoking.
Oh yeah.
I, like in the show about movie sex, I did want to talk about like the way that like female pleasure is censored. I do think that that's like a weird, if people learn sex from movies, because that's where it's coming from, porn or
that's
non-porn
where I
movies,
learned it.
Right?
That's how I found out I was gay, from looking at porn, and then all of a sudden I was looking at gay porn, and I was like,
this is where this goes. This is where my brain goes.
Right, and so that was it.
Yeah.
That was where it happened.
That's what I'm saying. So people, I think, have this, you know, even some people before porn have... that happened with a regular movie.
Just a movie,
like,
yeah.
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
Like Brad Pitt in
Legends of the Fall.
Legends of the Fall. You got me on that one. Or whatever, what have you. You have like some kind of like romantic thing.
Oh, yeah.
But then if that's your education, it's really lacking. Like there's so much that people don't know about sex if you only learn sex from...
Ooh.
From that, and then parlay that into your first sexual experiences.
Oh, you're going to be so disappointed, I think.
What?
By if you expect to have the sex that you've seen in a movie, the first time you have sex, you're going to... I mean, the movies, it's always like, you know, it's almost like everyone has an orgasm at the same time, right?
Yeah, like a woman in 30 seconds is orgasming. Like, that's unrealistic. Unless you've found like a
there's
a rare
something
kitty.
That really drives you insane as a woman. It seems like that's unlikely.
Yeah, I just don't think... I mean, with a vibrator, possibly.
Maybe.
But that's not how sex in movies
that's
is portrayed
either. That's not
what
you're going to
see. Sex toys aren't really, like, prevalent. Like, I feel like there's this whole vast like misinformation about what sex actually looks like if you're just looking at movies or porn, especially porn. I mean, porn is often so degrading, and
especially for women, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I mean, that's like for a lot of people, that's a part of it. That's a part of what makes it good for them, is, you know, the degradation, which is
the pain or something like
that.
Like
seeing face women fucking and
women
the...
are like so seem so a lot of I mean I haven't watched a lot of porn with women, but it always seems like this very That's an element of it, of like, you know, like,
yeah.
It's just really intense.
Yeah, it's like rapey, but not necessarily rapey, but, I mean, because the women are, like, taking it, but there's, like, definitely, I don't know,
I think gay porn has so much less of that, simply because, like, when you have anal sex, it kind of hurts. Like, it kind of hurts every time. So you almost want to watch, the simulation that you want to see on screen is this non-painful version of sex.
Yeah.
So gay porn has kind of less of that, unless you're like...
It's like fairy tale.
Unless you're like watching like kink.com or some specifically...
Yeah, going for it.
Specifically something that's supposed to be like that, that's what you'll see, but it's a funny dichotomy with the gay and the straight porn.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like gay porn is probably more like like hetero norm relationships in movies, where it's like it happens quickly and easily, things just slide in, and it's, you know, whatever.
It's like, definitely all about that. It's also another big thing about gay porn that you notice pretty quickly is they don't wear condoms a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. And that is also, I think, feeding into another fantasy, which is a fantasy of a world without HIV.
Yeah, totally.
Which, you know, in America...
Or that certain kind of responsibility in general, like any of the scary things that can come from sex without condoms.
Yeah, because in straight porn, it's like a sexually transmitted baby, you know, if they're not wearing condoms. Mm-hmm. That's like, honestly, to me, that's like as intense. I mean, it's different.
It's definitely intense. It's definitely intense. Actually, what's surprising about that is the lack of intensity. Like, people that are into, like, raw dog and proud of it.
Oh, God.
The lack of intensity that they give, like, the concept of a child is funny to me. Like, you'd be scared to get herpes, but not scared to knock somebody up. Like, they're both gonna be with you. Like, that's gonna, I mean, you know, whatever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're both huge, it all changes your life a little bit. Yeah.
What are you doing now? Did you accomplish your goals?
I think I'm right here at the end here. I think I finally figured it out. I died. I completely died and had to start
over.
Oh, you
lost all your lives?
Yeah, but now we're doing good, I think.
Wow, you are good at hopping.
Yeah, that was very easy. Okay.
It was?
The game did the legwork for me there.
I thought, like, you're really skilled at the amount of jump to do there. I don't know why. It looked very difficult.
Yeah, the thing about this game, it's getting harder as I get... I'm pretty close to the end now. And it's getting harder as I go along, which is, like, a new challenge for me as an interviewer, you know?
Oh, yeah, because you got to do more work right now?
Yeah, a little bit. But that's part of the fun, too, for me, of the whole experience.
How long have you been playing it?
We're probably in an hour, like, 26, 27 at this point.
Wow. And you've had a guest for each one of the things?
It's all... You can watch the entire 27 or so hours on YouTube. It's crazy.
That's amazing.
So
do you watch the, like, play... Play with me or whatever.
Yes, I do watch some Let's Play videos.
Let's Play videos. That's better.
Does your son do Minecraft? I was surprised to hear you not bring that up.
He does Minecraft, but he doesn't do it at home.
Oh,
like, we don't.
At home.
He used to play it at school, but I wouldn't let him play it at home.
At school, they let the children do the Minecraft at school.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And he would play. What other one did he play?
Why do they let them play video games at school?
It's just in the after school program. So he'd be like trying to stay as late as possible. So he'd like another, you know, especially when he's grounded from screens, because that's the punishment for everything.
Oh well.
You take the screens away. You have to. It's the only thing he cares about in the whole world. So you take the screens away anytime there's bad behavior or whatever.
What was a? Tell me when. Give me an example of when.
He's currently not on screens. I was telling you, like, we butt heads sometimes real hard. I don't even remember how the, like, what the genesis of the fight was, but it was like, I basically think I just wanted him to take a break from his screens and do his chores.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, you know, just flipping some tune. Like, it was like so melodramatic because I asked him to do the things that he does every day that he knows he needs to do every day.
Yeah.
And then it escalated and he locked himself in the bathroom for like 2 hours.
Wow.
Just super teen angst shit, you know?
Oh my gosh.
So I was like, you gotta go off screens. Like, I think for a month, you need like a clean break. So the only thing that he's allowed to do right now is I got an app for chores. And it's supposed to be for, like, 6-year-olds, but I got this, like, it's called Chore Monster.
Yeah!
And when you do chores, you get tokens or, like, tickets to try to buy.
Great.
You save up tickets and you get these, like, monsters. They don't do shit. I mean, you can click them and they'll do one, like, little thing. They'll bounce or something, you know?
Sure.
But there's no real point. But it's incentive-based enough for him. Like, you also put rewards in there. So, like, if he gets... you know, 2,000 points, I'll take him to Universal Studios, which is going to take him roughly, like, 3 months or something like
that.
So he at first was like, it's so stupid, it's for babies, and he's been literally like, I did all my chores today, it's working. An app for chores, it's working.
That stuff works all the time. I remember being in third grade, and we had a little loft that you could go, you would pay little coins to go up and read in, and it was like, and you had to be really good to earn the coins.
And so you could read.
So you could just read, but, like, in a little sky loft.
Yeah.
And it was, like, that was all you wanted in life, you know?
Yeah, enough. Yeah. I did Book It. Book It was with Pizza Hut. And you got, like, stickers that were, like, pizza pie-shaped stickers. And when you filled it out, you could take your card in.
In school.
Yeah, like, when you read enough. And I was, like, an avid reader as a kid. I start 7 books before I finish one. I, like, don't have the attention span anymore.
Right.
But well, as a kid, I read all the time.
It's hard to feel confident about having the time, I think, as an adult, too.
Yeah, because everything comes down to, like, productivity now. Like, my whole life balances on whether or not I feel like I got shit done.
Yeah.
And, like, whether or not I was a relevant human.
Mm-hmm.
Some days I'm not, you know? Some days I just watch Pokemon all day and fold laundry.
Well, but you're doing laundry.
Okay. That's okay, yeah.
You're doing laundry.
Yeah, but do you ever just look at a full day and be like,
oh, yeah.
What did I do?
Oh, yeah.
What did Beyonce do?
Well, she probably did a lot.
She probably didn't do a lot herself, but people around her probably did a lot.
Well, she has like 100 assistants, I think.
Yeah.
Like literally 100.
Yeah, I have a friend like that works with her pretty closely, and she said she is the hardest working woman she's ever encountered. So.
I wouldn't deny it.
So, I mean, it's not all her team. I like to talk a little shit, because do you remember that, that like meme, or like kind of, it's kind of pre-meme takeover on Instagram, because memes are blazing, still so hot these days, you
know?
Oh,
yeah, they're going hard.
But it was like, you have just as many hours in the day as Beyonce, and it was like infuriating to me, because I'm like, that's not real, like, because you have to times it by however many humans she has working for her, like, it's not the same.
Yeah.
That's not the same, is it? Is it
no.
the same? Do I really have as many hours in the day as Beyonce?
No.
I don't.
I mean, it's not untrue, but it's like, you know, we all...
If I had the output of a team of 100 people, I would like to think I would get some shit done.
At the same time, I'm not gonna deny that game is just insane, really. I mean, just the level of... Because I really think of Beyonce now as sort of being like John Lennon, in a way. In the way that John Lennon started out as just a pop star, you know? Like, the Beatles were just like a pop act. They were really talented.
Yeah, but they made poppy rock and roll tunes.
But they didn't...
They
weren't...
The
it was,
scream.
I Want to Hold Your Hand, you know? It wasn't really
it
about
wasn't
it.
Imagine
it
until
wasn't,
the end,
It
yeah.
wasn't about much, honestly. And now it's like... And then, of course, they, you know... did whatever and became really
Beatles.
The Beatles and political, and then John Lennon did his own thing and was political and experimental and very challenging in all these different types of ways, and I think that's very similar and sort of occupied that space in culture, you know, as like a just like, you know, John Lennon represents the 60s in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And I think,
and like the like people actively trying for peace or something, like a peace movement.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty synonymous with John Lennon.
Yeah.
And so what's Beyonce's,
well,
what is she? She's just a time...
I don't know if it's... I just think it's a similar thing of, like, you know, I think she's very political now. There's a lot of feminism in the work. There's a lot of...
But is it? I don't know.
No? Okay, let's hear about this.
I got some thoughts.
Let me hear.
I just am curious. I'm curious about any brand of feminism... And I'm not saying that I don't have personal feelings about this, too, but I'm just, like, as a concept, I'm curious about any brand of feminism where the ultimate goal, the ultimate deciding factor is your sexiness. Like, Beyonce's brand of feminism works for Beyonce because she is beautiful and talented and whatever. So she's not, you know, while we feel empowered by her songs, her, like, dancing in her underwear... I believe a woman should be able to wear whatever the fuck she wants, but I don't know that that there's empowerment in reducing yourself to a sex icon. Do you know what I mean? I'm not really saying
yes.
it the way I want to. But that brand doesn't work for everybody. She can empower herself because she's a diva, but that wouldn't work for a middle-aged woman. That wouldn't work for, you know, not, I mean, obviously, no one else can be Beyonce.
Yeah. And I think, too, with John Lennon, there was still this air of fame and commercial success, and that that drive to just be a superstar that I think anyone on that level has to have.
Yeah, you have to have like a...
That narcissism.
Has to be a narcissism, yeah. I mean, I work closely with celebrities and even the people that work around them, it's about a certain kind of narcissism.
Yeah.
Like myself included. I'm not trying to like throw stones here, but it's like you don't do... Like, the idea that I have this, I wouldn't want to work at a salon, but I do nails on set, and that I don't see the job that we do as that much different, but I do feel like what I do is, like, elevated. I have some sense of pride about what I do versus, you know, your average person that does nails.
Yeah.
That's ego. That's all ego, you know?
Sure. Well, now I'm just unsure of what...
Okay. With the spikes?
Okay, what is going on here? I don't know how, what this guy is supposed to do next. Let's see, maybe, because this person, I need to get my second guy down there. This was maybe, I bit off more than I could chew for this hour, because I think we're about to wrap up.
Okay.
Friend. But I've learned, now I know how to hit it the next time.
You can do well.
Right,
I'm sorry,
out of the
I wasn't
game.
Very helpful.
No, it wasn't you at all. It was just this game is getting insane.
It's harder
and
harder.
Getting insanely difficult.
It's so interesting because, you know, I don't have any idea what you're doing, but it doesn't look like the relatively slow pace of the moves being
right,
made.
This
it's
part.
Deceptive. It doesn't look like it would be super, super hard, but I can see what you're saying. You've got to do a lot of shit.
Yeah, I mean, it is like running on a timer. Like, if I just sit here and do nothing, these guys will obliterate me.
Mm-hmm.
But it is different than, say, Zelda, where it's... You know, you have a second to react, or Mario, where you have a nanosecond to react.
I'm into the
umbrella guy.
Yeah. Freaky.
He's good.
He looks like he would like fall from the, a man of many faces or whatever, like a many faced god.
Sure.
Like a, you know, like that's Arya Stark. She pulls off the thing, and she's the umbrella man.
I
Do you remember like way back when there was the scorpion, the little girl that gave the queen the scorpion?
Yes.
I don't know that was ever really, like, explained, was it?
Wait, who was... Which queen did she give it to?
I feel like it was Dany.
Yeah, okay.
At, like, some dock, you know, like, merchant...
I remember the moment, but I don't... Like, I can't remember,
I just,
like, if
I
there was
any... I don't think it was ever, like, explained
it wasn't. There was no functional moment or anything to it.
No, I just don't think it was ever explained. It was, like, I don't know. I think she... I was just thinking, I wonder if she was one of those guys.
Sure.
Mini-faced.
I hear ya. Oh, yeah, maybe they'll... Well, you never know. They might connect it all back.
I doubt it, but maybe.
You never know.
I think that one's long gone. How much... Okay. I find... Do you root for John? Do you still, like, have, a heart for John? Sorry to go back to Game of Thrones.
No, don't feel sorry about that at all. You know... I think he's a little bit emo for my taste sometimes.
A little Christ-like.
but I also feel, I don't know. I also feel, like, he's a good guy. Like, he hasn't really done anything that horrific compared to everyone else.
No, I was gonna say he doesn't have any blood on his hands, but he has. He's cut off heads, but only the people who deserve to have their
kinda
heads cut
deserved
off.
It. And kind of were coming after him, you know? He's really
like
on the defensive.
It was tricky when he hung that kid.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that
I mean,
was a lot.
He had it coming, but that's a lot.
It was a lot.
Because you can understand. I remember. I could understand why he did what he did.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. All right, well, now... Let's see. It's also this dungeon is really confusing. Let's see if I go out. I think if I go out here. Okay, here's a save point. So that's all I need in life. That's.
Oh, brilliant. Now we're good.
Now we're so good.
You've like laid the groundwork, huh?
So now I don't have to do it all over again. At least we're just back. We're back. We're halfway through it. We made it halfway through the dungeon.
Halfway through the dungeon?
Halfway through the dungeon.
Did you try to... You were trying to get all the way through the dungeon.
Yes,
in a
but
perfect world.
It's in a... You know, you can't always get what you want, as the Rolling Stones say.
I was going to say, I feel like I've heard that before in a tune or something.
Do you... who do you think is good? Who do you think is a good person? Any of them on Game of Thrones?
Jon. I mean, he's the only... He's basically the only one. I think Sansa has done very little... bad things. Her original sin was like she wanted to be the queen. Like she, you remember, like
yeah, that's that. I the thing about her that I think is such a huge payoff on the show was that now she's a little bit, you know, come into herself and more powerful. Mm-hmm. Whereas for so many seasons, she was just such a chore.
She's been everybody's bitch. Like, she's, you know, because she was Joffrey, which, like, can you imagine? And then if you think, like, that's a sadistic man, she ended up with Ramsay Snow. And in between, she was married to the Imp, who I...
It was nice enough.
Was nice to her. But still, it's... a sad, like, you know, you can get married off three times to people you don't want to marry, two of whom are downright psychos. Anyway, all I'm saying is, I don't think she is... She's not as good, I don't think, as... No, she's not good.
I thought Margaery was good, but now she's dead.
Yeah, and she was good to some... They all are, like, good, but with their own motives, you know? Yeah. Like, Sansa's original sin was that, she wanted to go to Westeros way,
yeah.
And she wanted to marry Joffrey.
She bought into it.
Yeah, and then, it was early on, and she was so young. I feel bad for like, trying to act like all that shit's her fault, because, really, she got served some shitty shit.
Yeah, and she didn't have a lot of power or agency, but, you know, Arya and... Danny didn't either, and they went out and got themselves some.
Mm-hmm,
even
mm-hmm.
though I complain about them sometimes too, you know it. You know it's a man's world on Game of Thrones. That's the thing about Game of Thrones. Every other fantasy universe, like Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter, you say to yourself like, "Oh, it'd be so cool to go there," right? Mm-hmm. I've never said that about Lord of the Rings.
No, I mean I would go to a Universal Studios ride where I know I'd be safe, but I don't want to spend time there for real. I don't want to teleport.
Suck.
No, but, for anyone. I mean, there's no one safe.
Nobody.
No one's safe.
It's a dangerous world.
True.
Anyway, this has been Let's Gay. I'm Johnny Jungle Guts. Thanks so much for coming on the show, Whitney.
Thanks for having me. It was fun.
Stay tuned. We are uploading twice a week.